Hello, everybody.
Hello.
We are here today to interview Johanna Sinisalo. She's a science fiction and fantasy writer from Finland, from Tampere, to be more precise. She has been an active author since the late 80s, but probably her best well-known book is from the year 2000, and it's Troll, a love story. It was a big success, both in Finland and internationally. But she has also written for the Finnish television. She has written short stories, so she's quite touched everything a bit. So welcome to the Eurocon.
Thank you very much, and thank you for having me.
I would like to ask you first if this is your first time in Barcelona.
No, it definitely isn't. I have been here, I think this is the fifth time I'm here in this lovely city. So I have seen all the, you know, must sights already. But I always enjoy immensely coming back here because I just love this city.
And I know that you like hiking a lot. So have you been hiking around here?
Well, yesterday I walked to Tibidabo from the center. It's not that long a walk, but more than an hour. And then I got the teleférico to the top.
Cool. And what about the Eurocon? Is this your first time in the convention?
I have visited a couple of Eurocons. I think the first one was in Hungary, Budapest in more than 15 years ago or something like that, perhaps more than 20 years ago. I have visited more Worldcons than Eurocons, actually.
Cool. Well, I would like to start first talking about your first book, because probably it's the one that most people know. And I would like to ask you a little bit of a personal question, and that would be, how did you feel when your first book was published?
Well, I had published quite a lot of short stories in magazines and anthologies before that first novel. So I have already got my work published, and I have gotten, you know, minor awards from the science fiction community in Finland and so on. So it wasn't that kind of high threshold that sometimes the first novel is. But of course it was very exciting because I thought that this was the first time I tried to write something in length and depth that was so different from short stories. And of course getting the novel published was a great thing, but for the first novel to get first shortlisted to Finlandia Award, which is the most prestigious literary award in Finland, and then I actually won the prize, that was something that I really couldn't believe that it was true. And in year 2000, it's 16 years ago, and in these 16 years there has happened quite a lot in Finnish literature, because in year 2000 it still was considered that fantasy and science fiction are kind of lesser literature, and the headlines were huge, you know, fantasy book won the Finlandia Award was something like that has never happened. No one could imagine things like that. And in that 16 years after that award, I have noticed that genre fiction has kind of become part of the literary fiction tradition in Finland. I think that prize of mine was something that made it easier to see science fiction and fantasy, or combinations of genres, as acceptable literary tools.
Okay, it was actually you also who kind of baptized Finnish science fiction as Finnish weird. So how did that come up, like that label?
Well, when you said in your introduction that I'm a science fiction and fantasy writer, I was thinking, oh my gosh, I'm so bored of these kind of definitions, because so many people in Finland, and I think also abroad, think that fantasy is something with elves and unicorns and magic rings, and science fiction is spaceships
and alien monsters and laser guns. And I don't read write either kind of literature myself. In my stories, the reality, the realistic surroundings are always very close to the places and people. They are like just a little bit twisted reality, if you can call it so. And so when people are labeling me as a fantasy or science fiction writer, those people who might be interested in my books don't read them because they are expecting unicorns and laser guns. And those people who want to have spaceships and unicorns, they don't read me either because they take my book from the shelf of the bookshop of the library and although there are no aliens, I don't want to read this. So who is winning in this game? I mean, no one. And that's why I wanted to launch a term that Finnish weird. It's kind of umbrella term under which you can put every literary work that is not realistic. That's the only definition of Finnish weird. It's not of the realistic tradition. And I know that there are a lot of writer colleagues in Finland who are writing between genres. They are combining elements of science fiction, fantasy, horror, surrealism, everything but the good old realism. And so it's very easy to tell, I'm writing Finnish weird. And so you are not, the readers are not expecting those spaceship of unicorns from you. And also my agent who sells my books rights abroad has said that has been very handy, commercial tool to label Finnish non-realistic books, Finnish weird. It's like that kind of name, commercial concept, like in crime fiction, there's Nordic noir.
Yeah. And in your work specifically, do you put any boundaries to the weirdness? Is there some point where you say, okay, this is way too weird, now I'm going to stop? Or you just let it free?
Well, in a way, I want my books to be plausible, to be that kind of books that the readers are easily immersed to. So that's why I like to use realistic places and names and perhaps just a little weird element here and there, because those readers who are not so used to read fantasy or science fiction, they feel comfortable in that world. And I know that many readers had said that I have never known that this kind of literature exists. So, but I'm not, calculating to get audience. It's just that I think that realistic writing is a very good literary tool too. So I want to compile it with the other genres.
And in the case of your first book, well, it's a bit special in the way that there's also a lot of intertextuality in it. How was the process of writing it?
Well, for those who don't know, in that first book of mine, there's a central character, if we can call him it. It's a troll. Trolls are mythological creatures, but in my book, they are living, existing animals. But they are not trolls like in fairy tales. They don't speak or they don't dress themselves. They are just wild animals, a mammal species among other mammal species. And those trolls are of Scandinavian or northern mammal species that is described in biology books. But of course, also in Finland we have a lot of animal fairy tales. So troll tales are other animal fairy tales there. So now I'm in a situation where I have to sell this concept to the reader, that trolls are animals, that they exist among us. The word otherwise is just the realistic Finland of our day. So I started to think how I myself could grasp on very strange concept or unfamiliar concept. And I started to think that everything that I know consists of little bits and pieces of information. I mean, we all know that there are nuclear plants existing, but very few of us have ever visited a nuclear plant or even seen one. And all we know about nuclear plants are that, okay, they produce electricity and they might be dangerous with the radioactive waste. And we remember the news of Chernobyl, and we know that Homer Simpson works in a nuclear plant. And all those bits and pieces, we form our subjective idea of a nuclear plant. And I started to imitate this kind of process, giving those bits and pieces of information to the reader about trolls. The biology textbook excerpt there, and a little fairy tale there, and some academical works, excerpts from those little pieces of newspaper writings. And all those were little hints that the reader can compile the idea of the troll themselves. And they are doing the part of the work for me. I don't have to tell everything. They are building the troll itself, themselves in their heads. And I think that was a very efficient way to write, because I have heard very many comments for sophisticated, educated readers who had said, "Oh my gosh, I never knew that they really exist."
Well, it happened to me a bit, I have to say. But yeah, and in this text that you have used for the book, like, did you find them like they are, or did you have to modify them somehow to?
Now, there are three kinds of texts. Some are totally fabricated, and then there are totally genuine ones. And then there are some bits and pieces that I have modified a little.
Cool. And from that moment that you published this first novel, how do you think you have evolved as a writer? Like, at least your books, how do you think that are?
Well, it seems that I have become much more critical, because this was my first commercially published work. The short stories and things were, you know, like in science fiction and fantasy magazines and anthologies that didn't pay much. And of course, this kind of big award gives you a lot of pressure. People are having expectations, and I think that the only thing that I thought is that I can't stop writing for myself. I can't start thinking about the audience and what they want and what they expect. And I had the I think the only way to write, in honest way to write, is to write that kind of books I would myself want to read. And I don't know if I answered your question, but I think that this is some kind of principle that I have to remind myself now and then, to be true to myself, to my quality of writing.
And well, your books are way very different from each other.
Like that was one of the principles. Yes, I started to think, no second part of Troll Story, because hundreds of people has asked me, can you write a sequel to that story? And oh no, writing is too much fun to use the same ideas over and over again. I want to experiment, and I have tried to, particularly trying to control that I'm not writing the same book over and over again.
And is there any kind of theme or something you think would connect them all together?
Definitely. Of course, I have tried to write very different books from each other, but I can't help noticing after six novels tens and tens of short stories that I'm very eagerly using as my themes, the relationship between humans and nature. That seems to, you know, come up over and over again. And the other one is power structures in human community, but also power structures, for example, between human and nature.
And talking about these power structures, you have written some books that have been from the perspective of male characters. So do you think that gender is a theme that would have something to do with your books? That do you think it's important in your books?
Ah, yeah, definitely. I'm a feminist and proud of it. For example, my book called Blood of Angels, it has almost only male characters in it. Here I was doing not calculation, but I had a kind of reaction from feedback, because some people I heard that had said that I'm so feminist writer that my male characters are all bad guys. I thought, oh, perhaps that might really be so. I have not been very, very gentle to male characters. So I decided that now I'm writing from a male point of view, and I want to write a book that the males are not violent, or not trying to control women, or are not assholes in general. There is one asshole in that book, but the main characters are very sympathetic. And I think that was very, very nice experiment. But of course, I usually prefer write female characters, because I think that I can write them better than males.
And you have also written a book for children. Right. How was that?
Actually, it's a book that it was in writing like 20 years. I have a daughter, and we invented together a kind of fantastical world, and bedtime story that was going on and on and on, and we draw a little pictures, sketches of the characters or creatures that were inhabiting that world. And then I found those little slips of paper from my desk drawer one day, and I thought perhaps I should write this down as a little book. And I started it again and again and again, and it never got onto its wings. It's just, you know, first two chapters, and it did not come alive. And then one day I just took it once again from my drawer, and I looked at it, and I thought, okay, I'm going to throw this away, and I start again from the first sentence. And that was a very good choice, because it was quite fast to write then, and it definitely is that kind of children's book that I would have loved to read when I was a kid. It really is targeted to intelligent children. Those children who wants to feel adult reading something that it's a little bit difficult but fascinating.
And now that you say that, as a child, did you already know that you wanted to be a writer, or it's something
yes,
that came later?
Yes, from the mature age of 5, I knew that.
And is it like an appreciated profession in Finland to be a writer? You think that it's well established profession there?
Yes, I think so, yeah. I don't think that we really do. Everybody knows those old stories that parents tell their children that you have to study to be a lawyer or a doctor or a dentist or something, you know, respected in a respected profession, and stop immediately that kind of artistic mumbo jumbo. That's a waste of time. No one ever said me that you should have to decent profession. Actually, I was working for 15 years in advertising. It's not respectful that either. But I think it's a quite good profession. Respect wise, but of course it's very hard to make a living because we are such a small country. There's only 5 million native speakers of Finnish, so we don't have that kind of market. Whereas I think in whole Finland there is something like 20 or 25 writers that are making their living on their book sales only. But we have quite good grant system. We have state grants, and we have kind of cultural institutions that are giving writers grants to work, and that makes it possible to people to be full-time writers, professional writers, even their sales are not that big.
And in the publishing industry in Finland, well, it's quite well known that everywhere, like publishers, agents kind of want to give their opinion in the scripts, like, I don't like this, or you should add this. Mm-hmm. Has that happened to you a lot, or have they let you do your thing?
Well, I think that in Finland, in every professional writing process, there is an editor who gives you feedback and points out your faults and gives suggestions how to make the text better. So, but I think that the good editor is someone who sees your quality as a writer and does not try to change you. They are just, you know, giving some guidelines how to make this original idea better.
And also one of the things that I like the most about your books is that they are usually written with the perspectives and voices of different characters. How did that happen, or why do you think that you write that way?
Well, I have very fascinated in the idea of the subjectiveness of reality. I mean, everyone sees the world and everything that happens only one single point of view. And one process of incidents, for example, seen from two different points of views can show that those incidents in a very different light. And that's why I like to bring that kind of polyphony to my texts, because the world is much more interesting and complex when you just see it from different points of view.
And as we said before, your work is composed of a bit of short stories and bigger books and then some screenplay. Is the story that demands what format you're going to need, or you just think, okay, now I'm going to write a book and then you start writing?
When you get that kind of grant, I am having a 5-year state grant this moment myself, before you apply or when you apply, you have to put down a very detailed working plan. And in that, I know that nobody is going to take away your grant if you are not, you know, following it precisely. But I think that if you have gotten money, for example, that for writing 3 novels, I try to write 3 novels for that money. And of course, if somebody like writes me an email and asks, we are going to publish this kind of, compile this kind of anthology of certain theme, do you have the time to write a story for us? Perhaps I can find the time for that. But when I have a grant, I try to stick to the plan.
And in your career as screenplay, you have worked a lot for Finnish television,
yes.
But then you also have, like, you have participated in this big movie. So how was that experience to be a part of Iron Sky?
It was very fun and were very, very educating. Those guys who asked me to lead the script team, they were very inexperienced in movie business, and they didn't know at first very much about writing professionally, but they learned awfully fast. And the idea of the Moon Nazis, I was the one who said go for that, because they asked me to come as part of the writing team. They had like self-published a movie called Star Wreck. It's in can be found in the internet. They're doing amazing special effects just by themselves. And after that kind of success, the Star Wreck was, they started to plan a big movie, a real movie, and they asked me for that. And then we were like throwing around ideas. I said we have to do a movie that is, it's your movie. It is not Johanna Sinisalo movie. It's your movie. And then they had some ideas, and I said, oh, no, doesn't sound good. I don't like that. And then the idea of the Nazis on the moon. The guy who came up with the idea, he was like a couple of weeks, he didn't dare to come to me and and present his idea. He said that he just thought that Johanna is going to think that this is something utterly ridiculous. And then when they said to me that, okay, I have this little idea, what do you think about that, about Nazis on the moon? Oh my gosh, now we are talking. And of course, when those kind of people who have no previous experience and so on, so that was quite a rocky road to go. But they got a professional producer to work with them, and then they got a fund, and then they launched a fundraising campaign, quite successful one, and then they began to get money from the professional financiers too, and they got a distributor and everything. But of course, when those those international people came to the project, the original script moved. It changed quite a lot. It moved on and not in all aspects to my pleasure. But I think the end product was very, very nice and pretty successful. And actually now I have an opportunity to tell all of you that next autumn, a year from now approximately, Iron Sky 2, the coming race, is going to be into the cinemas again. And in the same time, with that movie launch, there will be a novel adaptation of Iron Sky 1 by me, written by me, and it's based on mostly on those earlier script versions, those things that never got to the movie. So those people who have seen the movie do not know everything that has happened. It's all about how the swastika citadel was built on the moon, what kind of life, everyday life, they were having in that secret Nazi base, and how the main character, Renate Richter, how she grew up and what kind of schooling she had, and so on and so on. And a lot of material about those things that happened to her on Earth that the movie does not show.
And actually the working title of this new book is Renate's Diary?
The Renate's Diary, Renate's Story, yes. Working yeah. title, yes.
So it's from her perspective?
Exactly, and it's written like more than 20 years after the things happened, the first movie. So she's older, she's wiser. She can, you know, look back in a way that she knows now the big picture, which she didn't know when she was in the movie.
Do you think that this character specific kind of started living by herself, and that's why this story kind of had to be written?
Definitely, and because I spent a few years with the script of the Iron Sky. Of course, I know it inside out, those people and how they lived, and the movie is just a tip of the iceberg of this huge amount of research and ideas I had. So I'm so happy that I now have the opportunity to write this writer's cut of the movie.
And in this new movie, have you been doing something?
In the first process, when the central plot was formed, I was consulting the writing team.
You will not be like a cameo or something in the movie?
It was this close.
Okay, well, I would like to close a bit this interview by asking you, what kind of a science fiction reader are you? And if you have read anything lately that has kind of impacted you as a reader?
Well, I have this idea that the science fiction and fantasy genre, that they are very often thought that they are just escapist literature that is perhaps not very well written. And I think that these genres are a wonderful medium to express yourself in a very high concept literary way. And I think that Finnish writers in general are writing extremely good prose. And I read recently a young adult book by Maria Turchaninov. She is going to be translated, her books are going to be translated in several languages, including English. I don't remember if it's Spanish, but lots of languages. I think there are something like 17 different translations coming. And she is really, really good. And those young adult books are so beautifully written that when I read those, I was like full of admiration. And once again, I was convinced that you have to have ambition when you are writing, literary ambition when you are writing. If it's fantasy, it's science fiction, even when there are laser guns or unicorns, you can write well.
Well, I don't know if there's anybody that would like to ask something to Johanna.
There we are. Johanna, your latest book to be translated into English, The Core of the Sun, looks at a future Finland which has this very patriarchal culture. And part of the background of it is that the men of Finland have been deliberately breeding women to be more domesticated. And again, as you did with Troll, you've used this, you know, the Dos Pastos technique, the putting in of newspaper articles and academic essays and whatever, some of which were based on actual scientific research. Could you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
Well, the first I would like to say that of the book is it's happening in near future, but it's a little bit more alternate history of Finland than a future of Finland, because this process of domestication of women has been done from the 1800s already. And there really are that kind of scientific experiments that you can take in a couple of generations, you can domesticate wild animal into a domesticated one. There was a Russian scientist called Belyaev who did this with foxes. They only let those individuals, reproduce that were gentle in nature. For example, they didn't want to bite you when they were fondled or things like that. And so this Finnish government in this variation of universe I created, the Finnish authorities were very concerned about young men that did not have family or they did have jobs, and they were like very restless and creating havoc around countryside. And this all is genuine history of Finland. There had been in 1800s that kind of period of time that very violent groups of young guys were drifting around and picking fights and drinking a lot of alcohol. And in my story, the history branches show that the government thought that those guys were restless because they didn't have lady friends, and so they were declaring a law that every woman has to accept a marriage proposal if the guy wasn't like a convict criminal or something like that. And if they did not accept the proposal, they had to pay a fine, and so on and so on. And so it actually started to, those people, only those ladies got children that were, you know, submissive enough to accept the situation. And in that dystopia of mine, which is an utopia for some guys, ladies, almost all women are very submissive, they are incredibly stupid. Everything they want from their future is getting married, and they are fiercely fighting for guys' attention. And every child is raised from the beginning to grow up this kind of domesticated lady. But there are exceptions, and my female character is one of those exceptions.
Does anybody else want to ask something? Okay. Well, if nobody has anything, thank you so much for coming. It was a real pleasure.
Thank you again for having me.
And enjoy your time in Barcelona and in the Eurocon.
I will.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.